To all who are weary and need rest, to all who mourn and need comfort, to all who are lonely and need friendship, to all who are complacent and need disturbing, to all who sin and need a Savior, to all who are called and would serve their fellow man, this church opens wide its doors and bids you welcome.
Well, good morning and welcome to Rapid Ann Baptist Church here in beautiful downtown Wolftown, Virginia. So good to have you with us this morning. And we always start with birthdays. And I know for a fact this Tuesday, Paulette Gardner has a birthday. Happy birthday, Paulette. Also on that day, Pastor Jennifer Kelly has a birthday. And then on the 21st, Leona Dean has a birthday. And they've been going through a hard time lately, so I know that you'll appreciate maybe a card to Miss Leona. I'm sure there's more birthdays out there within the sound of my voice. So this is for you as well. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you and many more. Yeah. Well, for announcements, today is our Meals of Love event. And right after worship today, the meals that you have ordered to take to folks in need of a meal will be ready right after worship. You can pick them up and go out and take a meal from Jesus this very day. And to share his light. So much darkness out there right now. Who couldn't use some light and some good news? Other announcements, this Wednesday, 7 p.m., our men's Bible study group will get together. We organized last week. We've made a plan. And we are going to equip ourselves to go out and to share the gospel. Had a great group meet the other night, and they're excited. So, plenty of room. Guys, come on out. Join us for real study and fellowship. Now, our story this morning comes from none other than David McMullen. That's right, David McMullen approved this story. And it's a farm story, so you ought to know. And the story goes like this. One day, down on the farm, a bright, shiny government car comes rolling in. And out pops this young fellow, and he walks right up to the farmer and says, "I am a farm inspector from the U.S. government. If you don't believe me, here's my badge." Farmer looks at him and says, "All right, and I'm here to inspect every inch of this farm." Farmer says, "All right. But I wouldn't advise you to go out into the front field." "Did you hear me, sir? I'm a U.S. government farm inspector. Do you need to see my badge again?" "Okay, have it." Sure enough, the young fellow goes all over the farm. He's been everywhere. He comes back through, headed to that front field. Farmer says once again, "Now, advise you, young fellow, I wouldn't go up in that field." Fellow turns around and says, "Do you need to see my badge again?" And there he goes. Well, let me tell you, it wasn't no time before that fellow comes hauling rear end across the hill, going as fast as he can, and right behind him is a Charley bull. He's a coming and he's a hollering, "Help me, help me, help me." Farmer hollers out, Why don't you show him your badge? Oh, that's a good one. Now, in the spirit of worship, Rapidan Baptist Church. Scripture lesson this morning comes from Paul's second letter to the Corinthians. Be looking at chapter 4, verses 1 through 6. And Paul writes, "Therefore, since we have this ministry, as we have received mercy, we do not lose heart. But we have renounced the hidden things of shame, not walking in craftiness, nor handling the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. But even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing, whose minds the God, little g, the God of this age has blinded, who do not believe, lest the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, big G, should shine on them. For we do not preach ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your bondservants for Jesus' sake. For it is the God who commanded light to shine out of darkness, who is shown in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ." May the Lord bless both the reading and the hearing of his holy word. All right. Message this morning is titled, The Fishers of Men. In Matthew 4:19, Jesus tells Peter and his brother Andrew to come and follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. And one of my first experiences with this came when I was just a little boy. And one of the favorite rites of spring was opening day of track season. Opening day. Now my uncle and cousins and I would get all of our tackle together, making sure that we had plenty of number 8 hooks and lots of salmon eggs. Now some folks use cheese, but I always found that those oily, smelly little salmon eggs was a surefire bait. And we load up in my granddaddy's old 58 Chevy pickup. We get up in the back, and he'd take us over to a place called the Cherry Tree on the Hughes River. And the season opened at high noon back then. So we always wanted to get there by 10 o'clock to make sure that we had a prime spot by one of the deepest holes on the whole Hughes River. And see, in there, we knew there'd be hundreds of ravenous trout just ready to be fed. Needless to say, anticipations ran high as we waited the appointed hour. And if you had polarized sunglasses, you could see your victim staring right back at you, just waiting for 12 o'clock. But I'll never forget the year that about 5 minutes to 12, mind you, a telephone company folks drove up, parked, jumped out in their waders, and went right out into the river, right in front of us. 5 minutes to 12. That, beloved, was the first time I became fisher of men. Because you see, between my cousins and I, we hooked at least 3 of those fellas right in the seat of the pants. Accidental. But I can tell you this, we drew meat on 2 of them. But you know something funny? I don't ever remember seeing them fellas again on opening day. Now I've become the fisher of men that Jesus was talking about. But you see, I gotta tell you, I believe that it is easy for pastors to fall for all the latest tackle and lures in order to catch the most fish. It's almost like we're all cramped around the same hole of water, and there's so many lines out in the water that they're all getting tangled up. But all of a sudden, somebody pulls out the newest lure, throws it in, and starts just raking them in left and right. And everybody else runs out to get the magic worm, if you will. We've certainly seen these latest techniques experimented in many churches today. And some with mega congregations, thousands and thousands of people. And I get emails of advice all the time trying to sell their secret path to a mega church. Now suggestions have included fancy graphics, Christian rock bands, smoke, coffee bars, and then they suggest that the pastors need to dress down, perhaps even wear skinny jeans. Uh-oh. I have to lay that one aside. Says that pastors must craft messages to attract more people and never, never offend anybody. Follow these methods, they say, and you can't go wrong. Now, I fully understand why these things can draw pastors in. There's a sense of competition, not just for new believers, but also to hold on to the ones that you've got. And there's an urgency to find new and exciting things for messages each and every week. And beloved, that's pressure. It's self-induced pressure due to the fact that we've lost sight of what he was really asking us to do. Our scripture lesson this morning speaks to this very issue. Turn with me, turn back to our scripture lesson. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Everybody got a Bible? Crack them. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. I want to force to look at this verse by verse. Maybe we see where we've gotten off the path just a little bit. Okay? Everybody there? Verse 1. Therefore, since we have this ministry, as we have received mercy, we do not lose heart. What's he saying here? He's saying that since God has so generously let us in on what he's doing, that we're not going to just throw up our hands when difficulties come along. Sounds to me like a good message for all of us. Verse 2. But we have renounced the hidden things of shame, not walking in craftiness, nor handling the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. Here, beloved, is the crux of the matter, if you will. If my sole purpose here, standing here, is to craft messages just to attract more people while not offending anybody, then I've done y'all a great disservice. If I don't stay true, but rather twist God's word just to suit my audience, I'm not working for God. I'm really just self-employed, working for myself. No. I must be called to place the whole truth on display so that you all can discern for yourself in the presence of God. Sure, smoke and mirrors may draw some folks in, but only the truth will give them a chance in the faith. What is that truth? Well, John 14:6, Jesus makes it pretty clear. Red letters, John 14:6. Jesus says, I am the way and the what? And the truth and the life. And no man comes to the Father except by me. Boom. There it is. I know so often we wonder why so many folks just don't get it. You ever wondered that? How can they get it? I got this wonderful thing. How come Joe down the street just can't get it? All right, turn with me to verse 3. Verse 3. But even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. In other words, if our message is obscure or hard to understand by anybody, we can't allow that to be because we're withholding the truth from them. So with the truth revealed, what could the problem possibly be? Verse 4. Whose minds the God, little g, of this age has blinded, who do not believe, lest the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on them. You see, beloved, as true fishers of men, if we present the truth in love and they don't accept it, it's not because we weren't clever enough, nor entertaining enough, nor because we didn't use big and lofty language. It's because the God, little g, of this world has blinded them. All they have eyes for is the fashionable God, little g, of darkness. They think he can give them what they want. And then they won't have to bother believing a truth that they can't see. They're stone blind to the brightness of the message that shines with Jesus Christ, who gives us the very best picture of God that we could ever see. Now, you see, there was a time when most folks believed what this book has to say. But there's been a shift over the years, hadn't it? A lot in this last century. Let's just see, here's man, and along comes evolution. Come on, man. You don't really believe God created the world, do you? No, man, we came from a primordial ooze. Abortion. Come on, man. It's not a baby. It's just a lump of tissue. Same-sex marriage? Come on, man. That's love. And all the while, man, in darkness, is being raised up as this book is closed, placed on a shelf to collect dust. To collect dust. The Bible clearly told us these times were coming. 2 Timothy 4:3, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but according to their own desires, because they have itching ears, they will heap up for themselves teachers, and they will turn their ears away from the truth and be turned aside to fables. All right, folks, here's a gut check time. What is it in this book that you don't want to believe? What is it in this book that you don't want to accept, that you don't want to believe? Now, I fully understand there's some tough passages in here. Woo, that's some rough ones. Quite a few I can think of right off the top of my head. Yet I'm called to preach the whole word, whether it be in season or out of season. Well, preacher man, I hear you. But it seems nowadays it's even harder to get a so-called believer's attention. Why do you think that is, preacher man? Well, I'm so glad you asked. It's a great question. And I believe the answer lies in our complacency with the image of the fear of the Lord. The fear of the Lord. Because we've translated this over time to mean the respect of the Lord. And for the most part, believers can agree, yes, we need to respect God. Now, Proverbs 9:10 tells us that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. But get this, in the Hebrew translation of the word fear, not once is respect used. No, Check these words out. True fear, exceedingly fearful, and dreadful are the intended synonyms of this word, fear. Wow. That puts a whole new light on it, doesn't it? We see this fear manifested in Isaiah's encounter with God. Ooh, this is something. Turn with me, if you will, to Isaiah 6. Isaiah chapter 6. Now, you set your Bible on edge, cut it in half, you in Psalms, and then just move to the right a little bit. Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon. Boom, there you are, Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 6. Isaiah's going to have an encounter with the Lord here. Isaiah chapter 6. In the year that King Uzziah died, Isaiah writing now, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high, lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple, and above it stood the seraphim. Each one had six wings. With two he covered his face, two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And one cried to another and said, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. Now, listen here. And the post of the door was shaken by the voice of him who cried out, and the house was filled with smoke. So I said, Woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Can you just imagine finding yourself before Almighty God? I'll guarantee you one thing, it'd be knee-bending time. Mm-hmm. Ain't you just see Isaiah cowering? Not out of respect, but out of fear. True fear. The Bible says that you must work your salvation, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. And when you hear that verse, think of Isaiah. Another encounter similar happens to Job. Job chapter 42. Just turn left from Isaiah, go back, find Psalms, the next book to the left is Job. And the last chapter of Job is 42. Job 42. Now catch this. God, Job is seeing God in a whirlwind. And for several chapters, God has been speaking to him. And now he gives Job an opportunity to say something. Listen now. Then Job answered the Lord and said, I know that you can do everything, and that no purpose of yours can be withheld from you. You ask, who is this who hides counsel without knowledge? Therefore I have uttered what I did not understand, things too wonderful for me which I did not know. Listen, please. He's crying to the Lord. Listen, please. Let me speak. You said, I will question you, and you shall answer me. I have heard of you by the hearing of the ear, but now my eyes sees you. Therefore I abhor, I despise myself, and repent in dust and ashes. Whew. Beloved, these are not patsy two-foot encounters here. Rather, this is true fear of the Lord Almighty God, seeing them as unworthy as they truly were face to face. And beloved, I don't know how to break this to you. The only way to do it is just tell you straight out. that every one of us will have that same face-to-face encounter with God one day. And I'm here to tell you, if you do not know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, your appointment with God should quite frankly terrify you. Terrify you. Because you're going to be on your own. And you can't fool God, try as you may. However, if that's where you're staying right now, man, I got some good news for you. Or as the Gaithers put it, good news. You don't have to stand before Him alone. Romans 10:9 tells us, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. Confess your sins to Him. Repent of those sins. It means turn from them. Turn from them. And He will cleanse you white as snow. And the day comes for you to appear before your Maker. He won't see you as you were. Here's good news. He won't see you as you were. Rather, He'll see you as a sinner saved by grace, washed in the blood, and heaven bound. Yes, beloved, times might change, but the good news never does. I told you earlier, the pastors look for that magic bait, right? What's a magic bait? To present the gospel in love. Beloved, that magic bait is no secret. The magic bait is the truth. Tell them the truth in love. Then you're truly, truly fishers of men. Let us pray. Ooh, Lord. Thinking back to that song about the man picks up his paper and then the other fella cuts on the TV looking for good news. And Lord, I sure hope we can all come to the conclusion that we're not going to find it there. No. We find the good news in your word. We find the good news in your Son, Jesus Christ. Dear Lord, I pray this week as in every week, if anybody here doesn't know it, that you grab hold of him today while he may be found. These things we pray in the name above all other names, Jesus Christ. All God's children said.
Amen.
Amen. thank you again for joining us here at Rapid End Baptist Church. We always appreciate it when you take your time to do so. Now, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you, be gracious unto you, and give you peace. That peace that passes all understanding through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It's in his name we pray, and all God's children said, Amen.